So I'm an Italian archaeologist, and therefore I'm interested in farm animals. So mostly, just to get us out of the way, X is going to be some n-dimensional, smooth, and projective horizon over a P of K of characteristic zero. And in fact, there's such a thing only has the right to own one line bundle, which is the canonical line bundle. And that's the top exterior power of the Cotangent bundle. And in classification theory, we divide variety to divide varieties in varieties for which K is negative, so minus K is harmful. Those for which K is zero, and those where K is positive. And so this first class is final, and that's what will be interesting in today. And these guys are caviar, and these guys are general. So I will start with some historical remarks, and then slowly get into what we do. So let me start by talking about any two-dimensional. When any for one is trivial, the only part of manifold any for one is B1, the Riemann sphere. So let's start with any for two. And so these things were studied by Delafetzer. They're called Delafetzer surfaces in the 1880s. By the way, I'm very happy for people to interrupt me if you want. And also, don't interrupt me if you don't. You're better. So there are 10 deformation families of these things. Anybody? No, I can, but I will not. I will say something about this. This is a nice thing about algebraic geometry, that the parameter spaces are themselves algebraic varieties. And so these families are the blow up of P2 in at most 8 general points. And P1 plus P1. So these are the 10 families. And so, you know, this is a cloaking talk, let me talk about a little example here. So, you know, the first example I find out surface is a cubic surface in P3. So, I have a homogeneous polynomial of degree 3. And the locus where that from the forest is a cubic surface. And you know, I'm telling you that this thing is the blow up of P2 in number points. Set in fact. And that is not completely obvious, so let me sort of discuss it. The key thing that you have to show is that X contains a line. Literally, a linear line. But here's a proof. So it is four conditions being given. For example, the line x2 plus 3 equals 0, that's a p1 with coordinates x0, x1. And if the equation of x, you plug x2 equals 3 equals 0, then it's a cubic polynomial. And the line is contained, you know, that cubic vanishes, and that's for the inner conditions. Now, on the other hand, if you look at the space of all lines in P3, that's the Grassmann region 4, and that has dimension 4. So, you know, if I move my line around the space, then you expect that one of those lines will fall into it. It is not yet proof. There is an additional wrinkle. You have to produce at least one x that contains finite remaining lines. Some x contains finitely non-zero and usually the quantity for us the first course in algebraic geometry to develop enough theory, but then this thing is actually proof that cubic contains five.
And you should use that Grassmannian is complete.
Yes, yes, yes. That's part of that theory that we do. So, I'm not going to dwell on this too much. You will notice that it is not a constructive proof with a given equation, and it's still non-trivial to actually find it. So, there's a lot that you can say about this, but let me just not go there. And then, in fact, then once you found one line, you can find six disjoint lines, and then after that, you can construct your morphism to P2. Okay, so now let me move on to n equal 3. So, so here are some names. Well, these are final threefolds, and so we're talking about final, maybe 1930s. And then Iskowski. This is just the case B2 equal 1, and here we are maybe in the 1970s, and then Loewenkai in the 80s, and then perhaps some other contributions I would look at. So here we know that there are 105 deformation conditions. Of which 17 have B2 equal. So B2 here is just the runner of the second cohomology. So I just sort of want to sketch the proof of this theorem that there are 105 families, at least in the B2 equal 1 case. And I'll sketch the sort of Iskowski-Shapurov approach. It's in two steps. The first step is well, you have to clear some of the ground, but then you sort of are down to study five or three folds of degree 2g minus 2 and 3g plus 1. And this guy also always rotates a lot. Oh, this is the degree. I always put the degree as a subscript and the dimension as a superscript. So this is a trick. So this step is very tricky. And it's, it was done by Shakur. And then the second step, that's merely just trick. Or maybe not even tricky, but some complicated, is once you have a line, then you can use the line to project x to y in pg minus 1. And then y is itself a funnel of degree 2g minus 6, but of a special kind, because having blown up that line will have to contain a blow up of that line, which is an exceptional surface. And this is a cubic scroll surface. Maybe not just very special surface. And in this step, you sort of build up your knowledge. You understand the family and compound of pg minus 1, and you understand so well that you learn how to put e in it. And then out of this, you may or may not be able to make x. Yes?
When you start with the number g,
yeah.
But what if you just have some power that doesn't come to this? I mean, how do you classify it? You seem to construct it.
Said, oh, yeah. But I said that you have to clear the ground a little bit. And then once you've done that, the interesting different case is this.
No, let me just, can you say a few words? If I just have some random power with b equals 1. Well, I just did anything to do with this particular thing with some g.
Yes.
Which one is g? Which g?
Yes. Yeah. So, I can cover that. I can say that. That's fair enough. So, if x is funnel, okay, then if you look at the general surface, S in minus k, okay, then S is a K3 because by the adjunction formula, Ks is Kx plus S restricted to S, and that's just zero. But then now if you intersect two such surfaces, okay, then Kx restricted to C, or you know, this way, the canonical bundle of C is S1 plus S2 restricted to C, and that's minus Kx restricted to C. So you see, if minus K now is a very alkaline bundle, it put X in some projective space, and if I take two hydrogen sections of that, that's a canonical curve. A curve embedded with its canonical line. And that's how Fano originally defined these things. The Fano threefold for him was something with such that twice it's up to such a canonical curve. And G is the genus of that. So, In fact, I learned the classification first from Noy. I was taking my first term as a PhD student in Utah. He gave a course on this. So I don't know how to prove that there is a line a la Shokurov, but Noy gave another proof of that. And he says, I would say this is still unsatisfactory. This is a very hard theorem. And very, the proof is very not conceptual. And even if you assume that, then there is a lot of delicate projective geometry that goes into constructing these things. And it seems that successive generations of Alfred geometers have to reprove this theorem for themselves. And that's what we are trying to do as well. Alright, so here is direction 4. So I'll talk a little bit about n equal 4. We don't know much about n equal 4, there are some examples. So my guess, which is more or less educated, I'll just say guess here because I'm not going to be passing judgment in my own education. Is that there are tens of thousands of parameters.
Finitely many tens of thousands?
It's a theorem that is finitely many.
Ah, okay.
And I'm also saying that the scale of the problem is tens of thousands, not like hundreds. And sorry, maybe I should mention there is a related challenge here that I will not talk about, which is Q final threefolds. So if you do classification theory like I sort of do, then you know that you have to allow certain singularities to be completely general, and the final threefolds with those singularities are called Q final threefolds, and there are also probably tens of thousands of them. So this challenge is of a similar scale to that of non-singular final fourfolds. The methods that I'm going to talk about should apply to these cases, as in this case, but I'm not going to. So, if you already have a classification of fourfolds, then we need to move away from projective geometry because this stuff is too subtle and it requires human judgment and experience to establish even a single variety, and you never have the patience. Or the people do a classification of this scale, even if somehow one could find that the method, that traditional methods still apply. So about 15 years ago, Vasily Volov and Metcalfe, and he made the suggestion that we should use mirror symmetry. And by using mirror symmetry, we should classify the mirrors of the finals, and that somehow maybe the mirrors of the final are easier to classify than the final themselves, and this is one way you can do it. And, it seems a bit crazy because mirror symmetry is not yet a theorem. I mean, not at least in the level of generality that we can be able to do something like this. And we still don't know why the mirrors should be easier, although now we believe it. And so, 15 years to think about this, so we found some things, and I now think it is going to work. And I will tell you what it would look like. And I also want to mention that. Maybe not that one, maybe later. Oh yeah, I do want to say that we have a few people working on this, collaborators, and I'm not going to make the names. And you know, if you look for me in the archive, you will see my colleagues. So. Okay. So actually, I'm not going to talk about the observatory. I'm just going to talk about some of the thoughts that we came up with by contemplating mirroring. So I will talk about now sonic degenerations. So first I want to talk about tonic phonographies. And so, you know, this business N is always a lattice. Portion 3, so it's some Z, it's isomorphic Z to the N. But I'm going to have to choose a basis here, and M is a dual. And, okay, so maybe the key definition here is that a lattice polytope P in N from mean polytopes always convex, and lattice polytope means that the vertices of the lattice points. I say that that's what is final.
Is it N points or R?
Yes. Yes.
When you start with something convex in the lattice.
Yes. Yes. You take a convex envelope, of course, there are a bunch of points in N, it's an N points or R.
Yeah, but it's in N points or R, it's only N.
A lattice point of P in NR is final if, and we ask that 0 is strictly the interior of P, and that the vertices are primitive vector. So that's what the final part. And there will be several polytopes on board, and they will often be final polytopes. So after the final polytope, I can make it, another grid variety the following way. I take the polar polytope Q in M. That's no longer a lattice polytope. And so that's why I prefer to work with P rather than it's polar.
P is convex,
yep.
Right? Convex. Do you assume that it's convex?
Always convex. Always
convex. The definition was the convex always applied that set.
Yes.
Yes. So the definition is
yes.
And it's again, I guess, an N R, maybe?
Yes. So. I hope I don't mind. I'm going to write Q times 1 inside MR plus R. So I'm going to stick M at height 1 in a space of 1 dimension more, yeah? And then I take the cone spanned by this thing, and I intersect with M sub Z. That's a semigroup. I take the semigroup algebra over K, and X is the prod of this thing. So that's something I can do. So I'm going to draw here this cone, and the lattice points in that cone, that's a semigroup. From the semigroup algebra, the prod of that is my X. And it turns out that this is a phonograph, not a man. Single
In fact, it's a toy for us, see? And because, I mean, this basically said it has an action of a torque, T, and dimension of force, the spec of KM. That's what I start to love. So it's a singular funnel writing with a large amount of symmetries. Let me do an example so I make this a little more concrete.
Could you explain what is this ring K of funnel?
But if you can see the spectrum, just affine variety, what would be affine variety?
Yes. Yes.
So what affine variety would be?
Oh, you can see the spectrum. It's like the group, the multiplicative group of the field to the power n.
No, just say instead of xp, consider not Roche, but spectrum.
Oh, I see. Well, that would be a projective cone.
So projective cone on which one? It would be
all of this projective graph.
This? No, it's the same thing.
It's not the same dimension. Proj is dimension one less than spec.
Ah.
I would have been clear in this example here. Okay, so I could take this polygon here. I put a cross at the origin. Then Q is this polygon here. That's the polar of E. And so these are the integer points inside Q. And then I'm supposed to take it at height 1 in Z3. Okay? And so let me call these vectors here x1, x2, and x3. So for instance, x1 would be the vector minus 1, minus 1, 1, and x2 would be the vector 1, 0, 1, and x3 would be the vector 0, 1, 1. Sorry, yes. And this cross here, we call it x0. That's going to be the vector 0, 0. And you see, if you add x1 plus x2, plus x3, then that's 0, 0, 3. But then you're supposed to interpret that multiplicatively, and so then your xp is the locus where x1, x2, x3 minus x0 cube equals 0. That's a cubic surface, and that's the turns in P3. So, I mean, in this case, what I told you, to verify that, that is in final variety. And cubic surface. It has three single points. It's easy to see that the points are 0, 1, 0, 0, and the point 0, 0, 1, 0, and the point 0, 0, 0, 1. These are single points. And these are three A to singular. And by the way, this is a cubic surface on which you can easily verify that it has a finite number of lines. And so that's how you write down a cubic surface that has only finitely many but non-zero lines. So that finishes the proof that a cubic surface is line.
Do you assume some coefficients or no?
But this is what this is. There are no coefficients for this one. And so, you know, I'm really interested in non-singular final things, final manifolds. And these are singular, but it's possible that
so, you know, here is the slogan. In our point of view, we study X. Parodizes via their toric degenerations. Yeah? So there is a family of these things, and it's possible that for some values of the parameters, it becomes toric, possibly singular. And this is what happens in this case. You know, this is just one particular element of the family of all cubic surfaces, and it is the stock surface. I could take this one here and smooth it just by adding some random bonobos of degree 3. And so that's what we want to do. We want to study all possible torque finals, and then we want to then see which of those can be smoothed, and then we want to understand precisely when two different torque finalities can be smoothed in the same band. And let me make a disclaimer right at the beginning. We will only be able to see by doing this those finals that admit a torque degeneration. And maybe all of them do, but I don't even know how to prove that. Maybe somebody will go on and prove that. Okay. So I will talk about now the surface case, the case n equal to revisited. So this is the case that somehow we know what's going on, and the cleanest statements can be made in this case. And I will first make the statements and then explain what the various terms mean. So the first theorem is that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the set of final two polygons modulo an operation which is called mutation, and the set of deformation families of the precision. And theorem two, I will explain. And theorem two, there are 10, precisely 10 final p polygons after the mutation. Okay, so now if I told you theorem one, then I told you before that's not a great joke, we know that there are 10 diverse common sources. If I told you theorem one, why am I also telling you theorem two? Yeah, you may wonder. And the reason is, in the present state of affairs, you have to prove theorem two before you prove theorem one. Theorem 2 is a combinatorial statement about polygons, and that's when we know that, that's how we know theorem 1. So perhaps I should say this is a, so this theorem 2 is proved, is a combinatorial theorem proved by Kasparczyk
map is the easy one.
I'm going to explain it. And I should say at this point that a lot of my thinking about these matters, and especially the importance of mutation, is influenced by the discussions that I had a long time ago with Sergei Galkin over there. So let me sort of explain what these terms are. So first I'm going to explain mutation. This is an operation on final polygons. Combinatorial operation. On final polygons. I'm going to describe it in an informal way.
Only polygons or polytopes also?
So, there is a notion for polytopes, but we don't know yet what's the right notion for polytopes. There is a notion, but that's not yet what we look at. But I will only explain the version of polygons because this is exactly what's needed, so that's good. So let P be a final polygon so the G shape depends on the choice of some data. And the data is a primitive vector, or rather a pair of primitive vectors, one in N and one in N in the perpendicular to U. So fix these two primitive vectors, and then informally, and I will give an example to illustrate this. To mutate P, you have, for every integer k, take out k copies of the interval 0, u, zero v, because we have to be again. From P intersection U equal minus K. So this, if you read it, may look somewhat cryptic, okay? But I hope it will make sense, and hope I will accept. And so, by the way, you cannot always do this.
That's not clear whether
you want to
take out
K copies of the segment 0B.
K copies. K times.
K times, yes. Well, K times.
Is that different from the segment 0 KV?
No, but then, okay.
That's what this means, I mean.
Yes.
Yes. And what's A?
U.
Oh, U.
U. This guy here is U.
And is U dot V something? Oh, no, 0.
0. Okay, so I'm going to take P. To be, for instance, this volume here. Okay, I always put it across where the origin is. And let me take V to be 1, 0. And U to be So, you know, I think of U as a functional on N, and so this is the level set U equal minus 2, and this is the level set U equal minus 1, and this is the level set U equal 1. Okay? And so, how do I mutate P? So, for example, for k equal 2, I'm supposed to take out two copies of this unit set here from this set, the bottom set of the level u equal minus 2. And when I take it out, I'm left with nothing. Right?
Left with?
Left.
I can draw on the right. You draw nothing.
I just draw a point here. I will remember that I'm left with just this point, okay? At u equal minus 1, I'm not so sure what to do because these are not integers. I'm just going to ignore u equal minus 1. U equals 0, I don't do anything. And at u equal 1, I'm supposed to take out
minus one
copies of that, so perhaps I should add one copy. So that the interpretation would be that at u equal 1, I add one copy. And so at u equal 1, I add this copy of that set. And so, you know, if I'm doing things right, maybe now, yes, this is the mutated one. And it is. Okay. So it's not too bad.
Are you doing this only for vertices? Like, how do you distinguish?
You know how combinatorics is. If I give a precise definition, it takes me 5 or 2 words. Nobody understands me.
Except for dog.
So, you know, yeah, let's say just vertices. You're just subtracting something at the bottom and you're adding something at the top.
Can you describe it as some sort of Minkowski sound slash?
No.
No.
It's kind of tricky, actually. Okay, so that's the picture. Now I will tell you what's a T polynomial.
But you could have also done the other side. I mean, if you took out the two things, you could have done the main points on the right. And add this to the left.
Yeah.
But maybe not. What do you mean by zero? Do you really mean it starts at zero? Or is it?
I thought that the picture should be too clear. So, consider a lattice stone. So, a lattice stone is just some cone, a rational cone, and sigma. And so, you know, it's a cone, and on it there will be two primitive vectors, u1, or maybe v1, and v2. So sigma is the span of v1 and v2 for some vectors in a primitive. Okay, so such a cone sigma, then sigma has a lattice height. R, okay, not a number, so lattice height. R, and also in a lattice length. L. And that's the number of integer points that you have there plus one. And I'm saying that sigma is a t-cone if R divides L.
So what is R?
Gauss elements of the corresponding types in R. It's the lattice height, so you take the smallest integral vector perpendicular to this edge here, okay? And then you pair it with any of those points, there you get R.
Oh, I see.
And so remember that all my polygons contain the origin, and so I can form all these cones here. And I say that the polygon is class T if all the cones are class T. P, the polygon, the final polygon, P is class T if all its cones it means the question is, what does that mean geometrically? And it's a good question. So this toric variety XP, I define it as product of something. Okay? But in fact, it's a variety, so it's a union of affine pieces. And the affine pieces are spec. So this is a union over, you know, for a polygon. It would be a final polygon. This is a union over the edges of spec K. Let me call C the code over that thing. Okay? So C is dual intersection M. That's not the use. These are the affine pieces. And that cone is class T if and only if this is a singular, this is singular in general. The cone is class T if and only if this singularity is smoothable. That's the geometric.
No, 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 it's always
any singularity.
T, type T singularity. It's all singular functions.
You know, there's always something that goes a little too much. Okay, so I would say it for you. The cone is that T, if and only if there is a Q Gorenstein smoothing. And I'm only interested in Q Gorenstein because the other smoothing destroy all the geometric properties of my thing. So I only just work with Q Gorenstein deformation. I'm not interested in other definitions. So, and that allows me to discuss the result, you see, because basically there will be a map going this way, and it's going to be this much. I take a polygon P, I make the variety XP. Now, I know that all those, that's a union of affine pieces, and each of those singularities is smoothable. And a little bit of algebraic geometry allows me to say that, in fact, the whole thing is smoothable. So I take P, I form XP, and I smooth it, and then it becomes a smooth reflexive surface.
Is it a general statement that if you have a cover with Q Bernstein?
It's not a general statement. There are some, so you have to look at the thing, and you have to vanish some homology groups, and some groups of obstructions, and errors. But it falls within an understood theory, okay? So that's how it works. I take the polygon and I map it to the smoothing of XP. And then I have to worry that if I mutate the polygon, then those surfaces will smooth in the same family. So that's not so hard. So there is this map here, from this guy to that guy. What is completely not clear is that XP and XP prime smooth the same thing if and only if the NP prime orbitation is good. The if is easy, the only if is hard. And so that's why these people, Kaschuk and Prince, proved the combinatorial theorem that there are only 10 polygons at rotation. And that shows that if and only.
So you mean the map is surjective, obviously, right?
The map is not obviously surjective.
It's injective.
Because we don't know that every piece of
the top. You're saying you prove the surjectivity by knowing that there are 10 things on the right.
No, I think the subjectivity because I can construct a tonic degeneration for every Lepenza surface.
That's no, that's what I said. You know the things on the right.
Oh, yeah. Right. The thing on the right. Yeah, of course. Absolutely.
You are not, even when you said this, you're not giving the proof that you're only 10. You're using that.
Absolutely.
You don't have a new way to classify.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's correct. So now, the thing is that. There is now a conceptual proof that at least we get an injected map here. And this was sketched to me by Paul Hacking last summer. So, you know, there's a conceptual proof using Gross Hacking here neurosymmetry that at least we get an injected map. Now, now when is that a subjective map, then I have no idea to show a priori, although. This is easy enough. Should be practice. So, this is the equal to case revisited. So, So, what have we gained, right? We haven't. Yes, no?
I thought this was the new approach that would help you to go to higher dimensions. But even in dimension 2, you can't finish it without using it. It's already known.
Well, you have to break. But let me discuss precisely this now. Okay? What did we gain by doing all this? So, first of all, we have some nice conjectures, okay, which one they would do. But you see, the thing that we have here on the left-hand side is purely combinatorics. You see, remember that the main problem is that projective geometry is difficult and it requires human judgment to establish it in one case. Combinatorics may be much more complicated, but in principle it's easy. You can do it by computer. You cannot do projective geometry by computer, but you can do combinatorics by computer. And so, maybe a bit more complicated, but it's conceptually much more elementary, and it can now be done by computer. So, ironically, I'm sort of the Italian algebraic geometry to remove the word geometry from final geometry. Mm-hmm. So, let me briefly say a couple of things about now dimension 3 and 4.
Can you actually at least prove in higher dimensions that the left-hand side is a certain cardinality?
No. This theorem, even for polygons, is pretty tough. And, you know, I cannot understand because I'm not a
rhetorist.
Then we have, no, we definitely have a conceptual proof that is an injection, which is various. Yeah. Yes, correct. But this here is just because it, you know them explicitly. I do not know an a priori. That's the problem. Yeah, there are many gaps here, but you have to have faith. So the threefold things, okay, so moment, unfortunately, I cannot even state the Arrow theorem 1 and 2. Because I have some difficulties. We don't know what's class T. In other words, we do not know what dark singularities are smoothable and what are not. The information dark singularities in dimensional derivative 3 is much more complicated than in dimensional 2. And we don't know the correct class of mutation. Well, we do, but then we need to work with the decorated polytopes, and the nature of these decorations are very obscure. But we are making progress, and this is going to work, and we will have a version of theorem 1 and 2 for 3. We will. But what we do know at least a class of product singularities that do smooth. And this is enough for us to remake and construct all these 105 tests. And so this is work with Gross, Hacking, and YC and Greta.
Also has some R in, I think.
No, no.
No,
this is smooth, and so they are necessarily going to be contained in the future notion of T. That we know yet. Okay, so I want to tell you what this class of singularities is, and maybe I'm going to overrun by it.
So here you don't even take typical, or this is pure thought argument? Or notice, have you given a new proof that there are at least 105 values
yes.
with this?
Yes.
So you do not need to take it. They couldn't all be landing on the same.
Well, we do know that we get 105 because we can distinguish their topologies. And so we know there are really different values. But,
oh, I see.
But I don't know what's the class T, and I don't know what the mutation, so I don't really know how to find the left hand side. And so let me just very briefly tell you what this class of singularities is. So an AN triangle is a lattice polygon that looks like this. And here there are n plus 2 dots. And n equal minus 1 is allowed. And that would be just a second, a degenerate triangle. And suppose that I have a polygon P now, and I say that a Minkowski decomposition of a polygon P is admissible if all factors, all Minkowski factors, are AN triangles for some element. depending on the fact. And so in general, we can show that if you have such things, and you can have more than one, the set of admissible decompositions of P, okay, injects in the space of smoothings of the singularity. Well, I take P, I put it height one, I take the cone over it. But I take the dual of that intersection, M plus Z, spectral depth. So, if P has an admissible decomposition, then we have several.
What is Minkowski decomposition? Does P represent it as Minkowski sum?
Yes, absolutely. But I want it to be a lattice Minkowski decomposition, so I want all the factors to be lattice products.
And what means that? Say this, this unimodular isomorphism to this picture, I am triangle.
Yes, so it's a sum of things like this. So, for example, I don't know, you have a hexagon. Here's an example such a thing. This is a lattice hexagon. So, this is a Minkowski sum of this guy. And this guy.
Here it's two dimensional, but not three dimensional.
No, two dimensional. Because I'm looking at putting P at height one. And so basically, you know, the picture would be that I had some polytope. And I don't know how to draw it, how to do that. But then there's the origin inside, and out of it, okay. I have all these codes. Yeah. And the polygons I'm talking about is the faces.
Okay.
So, do this N triangle come the N triangle? And for more than one smoothing?
Conover N triangle has one smoothing, and you know this because the curve of the N triangle is just a bit of a N curve. And so, as an infinite dimensional deformation space, you're just smoothing those AN curves. But then very, very easily you find things that have more than one Minkowski composition, like this is this, plus this, plus that. Okay? And each of the two will be different components, topologically different components of the deformation of that singularity. Okay, just finish with one word. What about dimension four? We don't have anything in dimension four yet, but we've been assembling a big machine with big computers, and you're getting it.
All right, let's thank Enzo. More questions?
How about singular case? For example, the person, single person, the person focus.
So I haven't really considered too much singular. This would be good for quotient singular. All of this would be good for quotient singular. That's in principle discussable for me. And typically for surfaces, we've got a lot. We have a bunch of conjectures for log del vector surface. You'd be interested in this. So where we use arbitrary coordinates, and then module mutation, and that should inject in families of larger pairs.
But what happens near symmetries, which have some super potential, so what?
Yes!
Yeah, so
okay, so the super potential is Laurent polynomial with Newton part of this part. And the question is, what is that Laurent polynomial? So let me tell you what that Laurent polynomial is, at least in these cases where something is admissible. So here, if dots correspond to monomials, and so I put coefficients 1 here, and then I distribute some binomial coefficients on this edge. So here I will put 1, 3, 3, 1. Okay? So for all the AN factors, I make these Laurent polynomials with these coefficients. I multiply all them together, and then I have a Laurent polynomial which is supported on the space, you know? And it has sort of binomial coefficients along the energy constant edges. And so I do this on every phase, then I settle that with a Laurent polynomial. That's the superpotential that's mirrored to the smoothing of that singular toric fiber.
You have several Laurent polynomial.
Yeah, but I multiply them all together.
Ah, so you multiply.
So I get one on each face. And they have the same coefficients on the edges, so together they will find a unique Laurent polynomial with Newton part of this part.
So what is the plane? So it's some. So this potential will be what?
No, but the mirror to a final is a Landau-Ginzburg protocol, so it's for it.
This potential, this Laurent polynomial, is the mirror to the final that I obtained by smoothing that singular part. That's the claim.
So it's theorem or claim?
It depends. What the meaning of mirror symmetry is. We have a paper where we verify some central prediction of mirror symmetry. Namely, we can reconstruct the quantum cohomology of the file from that potential. So to that extent, it is a theory.
Other questions? Not let's thank the lecture again.